Okay, let's move right along and talk about supply. Supply will be pretty easy to talk about if we understand demand dynamics. Supply dynamics are of the same sort. A supply curve shows the quantities offered by sellers at various prices. Supply typically slopes up. It's not always the case, but it typically does slope up due to increased marginal costs. Marginal costs typically rise with increased production in a fixed time period, in the short term. Now, there's an activity we do in class called the bread factory. It's a simulation of production, and it's very simple because it only uses chalk, the chalkboard, and workers from the class, students. What we do is we only increase one input. We only increase the number of workers. We hold everything else constant. And what we see is that we can get more bread produced, but the extra production we get from adding extra students gets less and less and less. This is called diminishing marginal productivity. So because of this law of diminishing marginal product, if we have to pay extra workers the same fixed wage, but they provide less and less and less additional output, what that works out to is, in practice, is a higher and higher cost of producing extra units of the product in a short period of time. Now, if all of that flew past you, just remember that the supply curve slopes up. We actually calculate the results from the bread factory with some assumptions about the cost of the workers and the cost of the ingredients and so on, and we come up with some actual data. We graph out the cost curves and then the price line. The takeaway is I'm going to produce bread, and we'll get into all this stuff here later on in the class, but I'm going to produce bread at the point where marginal cost equals marginal revenue. That's going to be my profit maximizing level of output. And then to produce more bread, what's going to have to happen? Well, my costs are rising right here. So in order to produce more, I'm going to have that price rise. If the price rises, I will produce more. And if the price rises again, I will produce more. So my output is going to be governed by this rising cost curve. And the only way to get me to produce more bread is to have the price rise. So that constitutes the supply curve. Remember, the supply curve says how much producers will produce at various prices. I will produce more at higher prices because my costs are rising at the margin. Okay, so there's our upward sloping supply curve. Now, the supply dynamics are going to be exactly parallel to demand dynamics. A change in the price of a good does not change supply. When the price changes, the quantity supply changes. In order for this whole supply curve to change, for that whole supply curve to move, we have to have a change in an underlying determinant of supply. So what are those determinants? Technology is a big one. In the bread factory, I will introduce a tool that allows students to double or triple their productivity. And what that means is that one worker who costs the same wage did not produce twice as much or three times as much output. Well, what's that doing to the cost of output per unit? It's slashing it in half, maybe. So that would be shifting the supply curve down and to the right. Technology usually advances. So what that means is that technological innovations are typically making businesses more productive and pushing cost curves down, pushing supply curves to the right. Taxes and subsidies. A tax is just a cost of production, tax on producers. Just like the price of inputs, in the bread factory we have to pay for the workers, we have to pay for the flour and the water, we have to pay for electricity, we have to pay for machinery. You have to pay rent, wages, interest on your asset inputs. You have to pay profit to the entrepreneurs. Taxes are kind of a cost of not being in jail, because if you don't pay the taxes, that's what happens to you. And if you don't believe me, just ask Willie or Wesley. Wesley just got out of the federal prison a couple years ago. He was in there for not paying his taxes. That really impaired his ability to be in movies and earn money.
Shit! I've been cut already? Who the hell is that? Get him a uniform.
You got to pay those if you want to stay in production. So if the taxes go up, your costs go up, and your supply curve will shift to the left. Now, input cost is an obvious one. If the cost of flour or the workers rises for the bread factory, the company needs a higher price on bread to stay in business without losing money to cover its costs. And if those costs fall, bread factory can lower its prices to capture more market share. The number of producers. We add another bakery with identical cost. What would happen to the supply of bread? Well, it would be shifted to the right. It would be doubled. And finally, expectations. What happens to the number of people willing to produce bread at any price if everyone is expected to go on the Atkins diet? Now, the Atkins diet you might be familiar with is an all-protein, no-carbs diet. So if everybody really embraced this, what would happen to demand for bread? Well, demand for bread would disappear. But foreseeing that demand for bread is disappearing, what would bakery companies do? Would they continue operating? No, they would eventually have to shut down. So if this became a really big deal, I don't know how big a deal it is anymore, but if it did, that you'd see a decrease in demand for bread, and then you would consequently see a decrease in the supply of bread. Okay, so to summarize determinants of supply, technology, taxes, expectations, price of inputs, number of producers, we can use a similar kind of acronym here. Now it's TTEP number. TTEP number is a way to help you remember the categories for determinants of supply.
Okay, now let's conclude on our talk about the supply curve by just thinking about how shifting the supply curve works in the graphical space. So here we have an upward sloping supply curve, which, as you'll recall, I noted that's typical. It doesn't have to look that way, but that's pretty common. And that supply curve is going to shift to the left or the right if there's a change in one of these five determinants of supply. So if there's a new production technology that lowers the cost of producing a good, we can shift the supply curve to the right. If there's an increase in taxes on certain kinds of businesses, that will shift the supply curve for the products they produce to the left, and so on. So here's what that looks like. Okay, so let's say we have a reduction in the price of inputs for a product. So now we've shifted the supply curve down and to the right. So how do we want to think about this? Okay, there's kind of two ways we can read it, and this is going to correspond, you'll notice, to how we think about shifting demand curves. So we started with an initial price. I'm just going to put a dollar amount here that was the, I'll say, price that determined how much of the product a business would produce on a given supply curve. We'll call that Q1. And if the supply curve shifts down and to the right, we can say, well, at that price, they will produce more of the good. Why is that the case? Well, because the cost is lower and now they're making a higher profit per unit, so they're willing to crank up the production of the good. Alternatively, we can think about looking just at the quantity and what's true about the quantity. So at Q1, we are going to stay at Q1 and the supply curve shifts to S2, well, now we're moving down to that new supply curve and we're saying this company could produce Q1 at a price, much lower price, of P2 way down here. Okay, now is price falling? Well, or is quantity rising? Well, we don't exactly know. That's determined by the interaction of supply and demand. So we'll have to put both these things together. So we'll get to that here soon. But that's what happens if the supply curve shifts to the right. Now let's do the same type of analysis if we have the supply curve shifting to the left. Let's say several of the companies producing this product left the market. That would cause the supply curve to shift to the left. So likewise, again, we can say here's P1, the initial price that we thought prevailed in this market. And here is the quantity that companies were producing. Let's call it Q1. Okay, now after supply curve is shifted to the left due to exit of several producers, the quantity produced is going to go down. And if you think about it, that just is obvious. If there's fewer producers, there's less production capacity in this industry, and so the quantity has to go down. We could also, again, think about what happens just if we keep the quantity constant. Well, we're going to say the remaining companies need a higher price to stay in the market, so price would have to rise to P2. If we held quantity constant at Q1. Now, which of these happens? Again, we don't really know. We're going to have to draw a demand curve in here, and reality is probably going to be somewhere in between. We'll go from equilibrium A to equilibrium B. But I'm smuggling in the concept of equilibrium now, which we haven't really addressed yet, and that'll be the content of the next lesson. So stay tuned for that, and we will put everything together now. Demand curves, supply curves, where they meet, equilibrium, price formation, and then we'll be ready to utilize the supply and demand framework and work through scenarios where we're shifting either supply determinants or demand determinants, or in some cases, maybe both, and then see what happens to price and quantity in a market. And now we're really ready to do some essential microeconomic analysis. So stay tuned for that. I'll see you soon.